rather than the drip, drip, drip.
That means it's time.
It's time.
Yeah, must be to start. Yeah, 3:30 at mine.
Okay. Right. Well, mine is still maybe a minute or two behind, but seeing we're introduced here, we'll call our meeting to order. If you will all stand and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, liberty, and justice for all. I'm going to turn my back on you guys, but the flag is across the street so I can look out the window. All right, so we will call our meeting to order. First item on the agenda after the pledge is approval of the minutes from our January 18th meeting. Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
I second it.
Chair votes aye. All in favor? Well, I guess all in favor say aye.
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 Chair votes aye. All right. We'll get it straight yet. All right. Next on the agenda, financial reports.
But remind the board members that as Lisa's closing out the year end, we have limited financials available, but we do have report of billing for January 2021. And you can see the quarterly metered billing is up, as well as the monthly billings that are shown on the report. Most of that is due to the a change in rates. Cash reserve figures, you can see that's about where expected to be at the end of 2020, heading into January 2021. Don't have any additional comments there.
A good portion of that, though, is set up in reserves.
Yes.
In restricted funds, I should say. Okay. We need a motion to approve the vouchers, or we've already done that with our signatures, correct?
Yeah.
Yeah, I would request a motion on that, Sherry.
I would so move.
Second that.
And moved and seconded. All in favor say aye.
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 Chair votes aye. Gary. Moving on. Go ahead, Joe.
Well, for the... no further report on financial. For the superintendent's report, I'll start with construction, maintenance, and distribution. We had a total of 6 water main breaks in January, mostly on 6-inch water mains, older mains. One was on a 4-inch at 1518 Huron Avenue. That would be a very old main, 4-inch substandard size. So the crew was very active in January, and that's continued in February. They were out over the weekend several times as well. Some hydrant work associated with one of those main breaks. We did aid in installing the second wholesale water meter at the new Aurora Hospital site. The water utility owns the water meter. The meter pit and associated controls are owned by the Village of Kohler as a wholesale customer. We did have a staff member who was inspecting the water main installed in the Stonebrook subdivision. It's on the far south end of town, east of Highway OK. So we've got, we actually have a large main going in there for an east-west transmission, and also smaller main serving the subdivision itself. Elsewise, I would report in operations. We'll go through the monthly January report. We pumped a little less water than we did a year ago. No real explanation. 4% less this January compared to last January. Water temperatures in the lake water were a little warmer than usual. I wouldn't say warm, but warmer. We did not have to go into winter operational mode in January because the raw water temperatures were normally above 33 degrees. That's our cutoff. When we see a temperature below that, we go into what we call winter ops mode. And that helps reduce the chance of frazzle ice buildup. But we did not have to do that in January, which is a little bit unusual. Otherwise, nothing unusual to report for January. You do have the detailed maintenance list to review. Typical a variety of different work to keep the plant up and running. One small element that pops out, we've been installing a lot of new LED lights as we can. Those, I think we're all aware, those have become very both efficient and but also very effective lighting. So we're using a lot of those in the plants now as well. And I think you also have the annual operation report for 2020 versus 2019. There's a lot of information there. You know, basically 2020, we pumped less water than in 2019, and that affects most of the expense numbers and other numbers, of course, our use of raw materials, electricity, natural gas, chemicals was all down because we pumped a little less water. There's a pie chart showing that for our production expenses, electricity is about half of our expenses, including sludge disposal, natural gas, and chemicals. Yes, otherwise, on the annual report, I won't go into too many more details, but you can review that as you would want to. And then customer relations and fiscal, CR and F for January.
If I may ask, have we had any icing problems now in February?
We have not. We did go into winter ops mode, but we have not seen any icing.
Okay.
We are aware that at least two of our neighbors have had some icing events, but we have not.
Okay, good. Thank you.
Looking at the CRF report for January, we did reopen the pay window, but there's much less activity there. Not as many people out and about. More people using Dropbox, more people using electronic payments. You see, we mailed out about 5,600 paper bills and about 1,900 email bills. Collections, of course, we're in a suspended disconnection program, so we do have larger outstanding bills due than we would normally see. So at the end of January, we're outstanding about $78,000, and that would be sewer, water, garbage, and recycling fees altogether. Otherwise, we did have one water service line leak that developed that was an old leaded service that was replaced, and we were able to enter that customer into our lead service line replacement program and get one more lead service line out of the system, which is good. Website activity, about 2,876 visitors to our web page, mostly on the pay your bill location. We did have a lot of Facebook people reached on our one of the photos used in the raw water improvements presentation. Kind of a, I don't know if it's an aerial, no, it's a Google Earth, I'm sorry, Google Earth photo showing the location of the plant and the lakeside and where a future intake might be located. I think otherwise, well, those are the highlights for CRR&F for January.
Any questions for Joel?
None for me.
No, I'm okay.
All right. Moving on to items previously held over for discussion or possible action. The raw water improvements project, Joel?
Yeah, a few things on RWI. I did make a presentation to the committee of the whole in January. Appreciated the opportunity to do that. Did post the PowerPoint online and distribute it in various ways. Sheboygan Press picked it up and ran an article on the project as well. I didn't receive many contacts after those public outreaches. I think people are aware that that's a critical project to replace aging critical infrastructure to provide water for the community. I did present our updated cost estimates. We realized it's a costly project. We're trying to make every effort to right size it so that we do not end up with stranded assets or spend any more money than we need to. We have trimmed the project in several waves to really get the essence and no more out of the project. In terms of rate impact, you know, that's a hard thing to predict going years or decades into the future. I would say a few things. Project impacts our costs in several ways. The first and largest way is debt service. So there's no way to build a project like that without incurring new debt. How public utilities pay for projects. We would use a small portion of our cash in that project as well, but mostly we're paying for it with debt, and we then have new debt service going for 30 years, if not more. That's the largest new cost item. And really, the size of the project and the marketplace dictate the terms of what that debt is going to look like. Right now, the marketplace is pretty attractive. We're all aware interest rates are low, and that means we're going to get a fairly low interest rate on that debt for 30 years. Size of the project, I mentioned, we are right-sizing it. We are trimming it and have done that. We're hopeful of a good bidding environment. There aren't handfuls and handfuls of contractors that do that type of work, but I'm told there are enough that we should get a good competitive bidding environment. The project also results in additional electrical expenses. We would be running a new pump station. It should be more efficient than our current pump station. But we're going to maintain existing systems, so we're going to have some additional maintenance costs in maintaining both systems. Those shouldn't be huge, but they will be part of what we'll see. Another big aspect is the municipal payment in lieu of taxes, the pilot payment. Whenever the utility adds plant structure, the pilot payment goes up, and that will be true for this project as well. And that's a new cost that we have limited ability to have any control over. I think the board members are aware that the utility accountant and I have looked at these costs and projected them into the future, and we can certainly see that rates and revenues will need to go up to pay these new costs. We're hopeful that the community and our customer base will grow. With that kind of growth, we have revenue growth without a need for rate increases. Hopeful of seeing businesses come into the South Park Enterprise Campus. That's not the name of it. I can't try it myself. Yeah, excuse me. And hopefully some of those customers will be water users that of significance in terms of water usage that will help revenue growth. Rate increases themselves, we know over the coming 10 years, we will see a pattern similar to, well, what I would propose, a pattern similar to what the board has set forth in the past, which is looking at rates every 2 to 3 years and approaching the Public Service Commission with a rate increase. It's important to recall that neither the board or the Common Council or utility staff set water rates. Those are set by the Wisconsin Public Service Commission based on our actual expenses and revenues. They have a very complicated financial model that they use for public utilities. Public utilities are allowed a very moderate rate of return on their operation, so there is not something like much adjustment in that rate of return either. Things like wholesale water rates are also set by the state. We do not set those locally. They're set because public utilities are a monopoly in operation. The state takes jurisdiction and sets those rates in a fair, equal manner through all public water utilities. So what I would surprise is that for the RWI project, we're going to see rate increases at that interval. And I know the board has been committed to keeping those rate increases either single digit or lower double digit figures. And we expect that would be the case as well going forward. There certainly will need to be some lower double digit increase figures, I would estimate, unless we see just a lot of water use coming into the community and water revenue going up in that way. Otherwise, we're continuing in the detailed design phase. We're having meetings every 2 to 3 weeks with CDM Smith and our consultants. One of our next big steps is to submit a construction authorization to the Public Service Commission. You know, here again, as a public utility, the state has to approve an expenditure of this size. The local entity can't make that decision on its own. The state has to authorize that expenditure. They're aware of our project. They've given us feedback on our project to help right-size it. And they've told us to expect a nine-month review process, so we're planning to go in for that authorization within the next month or so and get that process started. I would just reiterate that in January we did submit for a FEMA BRIC grant on the shoreline protection system that's part of the RWI project. That system, at the end of the day, has a construction estimate of about $1.6 million. The state helped us with preparation of that application through the Department of Emergency Management, and they felt that it's got it met all their thresholds to move on, so to speak, in terms of benefit to cost analysis. They don't know whether we're going to be funded or not, but they felt it was a competitive application, so that now has been submitted. And I'd remind the board, FEMA BRIC is a 75% grant, so we could see, if we're fortunate, a $1.2 million grant towards the project. That would be very nice to have. We did also submit a request for endorsement to Senator Baldwin's office. During 30 days, they're allowed to offer endorsements on projects as well, so that is underway. And finally, I would say we had a lot of discussion about a FEMA BRIC grant for the entire project. And although that sounds, you know, like a wonderful thing, and would be, there's some real caveats there that we're still exploring. You know, FEMA BRIC grants are intended to mitigate the impact of natural hazards. So the shoreline protection aspect, you know, is clearly related to the hazard of shoreline flooding in Lake Michigan areas, which is a known natural hazard, especially as lake levels go up and wave action increases. However, the entire RWI project has a lot of elements that really have nothing to do with hazard mitigation, you know, such as pipeline in the lake for water intake. So after more detailed discussions with our contact at Wisconsin Emergency Management, getting a little bit of a mixed message on whether RWI in its entirety would even pass the first threshold, which is called the benefit analysis. So we're hoping in the next few weeks to go through that analysis with emergency management and see what the outcome is. If the outcome shows that there's not a high enough ratio of benefit, then there's no point in pursuing an application because you're not going to make the threshold. And she had many projects in the state that simply didn't meet that threshold and weren't unable to move on. That's one reason she worked with us to kind of tailor the shoreline protection project. But I believe in the coming weeks, we'll go through that analysis on the larger project and see what the outcome is. If it doesn't meet the threshold, then we're pretty much done. We can't do anything to change the project. If it does, then we'll have more consideration, you know, what really is our likelihood of success, how would it impact the project timeline, and what resources would we have to expend to make a full application. So I'm hopeful that in the next 4 to 6 weeks, we'll be able to answer more of those questions. Meanwhile, I've also been working with our financial consultants, Wisconsin Finance Professionals, Ms. Carol Worth, on updating possible funding mechanisms with the latest information, latest marketplace data, and safe drinking water loan information, and that now has all been updated as well. But I think just in summary, there's We've been through a part of our public outreach portion of the project. I think a lot of people now are aware of the project and excited about it. It's a very exciting project for the community. And we're moving in a lot of into a lot of details and continuing forward towards completion of detailed design in June of this year.
Any questions or comments from the board for Joel on the Raw Water Improvement Project?
Not for me.
Not at this time.
Do we have any timeline as far as when we'll hear from? I know you just mentioned a month and a half. When we hear from FEMA on that?
I believe the time frame for the shoreline protection application is, you know, roughly July, August of this year.
Okay. Okay, thank you. All right, no further questions. Moving on the agenda, number 4.2, review of policy on renewed disconnection program.
So last month we had a discussion and the board took action to resume the disconnection program when allowed to do so by the Public Service Commission in April, April 15th. The moratorium is ending. So the key elements of what we would be resuming are shown here and were what we discussed last month. We'd be changing the threshold for disconnection from $150 up to $300. We'd be reducing the down payment on a deferred payment agreement to 25% down from 50%. The other issues are pretty much what we had in place before with the disconnection program. And just as an example, an average customer using 15 cubic feet of water per quarter, that's a fairly small usage, has a total bill from the water utility of $152. But of course, that includes sewer garbage and recycling, and water is about 40-45% of that normally. We would be phasing the program in based on districts. We have four districts. I'm sorry, we have monthly. We have the three districts that are shown. We would be phasing in first district number three with a disconnection date in April. And you can see the subsequent dates there as well. And none of that is really changing. As per the Public Service Commission, the notification to customers is mandated, and we do that either by phone calls, disconnection notices on door hangers, or combinations of both. We do refer customers to financial assistance from St. Vincent and the Salvation Army. If they meet the threshold, they are funded by those entities sometimes. We're aware that another payment option might be coming with a new program to help people avoid eviction and foreclosure. Avoid foreclosure. And utility payments are included in that new program as well, but we don't have details yet on that. And finally, as of February 4th, we had 184 customers pass to over that $300 threshold. We did send all past dues prior to November out on tax rolls last year, but in some are missed in that process or come after that process. So currently we have 184 members that would be in that category. So I think in response to what the board had requested or directed last month, that is the written policy and how we would plan on going forward with the disconnection program.
I have one question, Joe. If we don't have a phone number associated with the account, do we actually roll a truck three times to hang door hangers or just once?
We are required to make multiple attempts, so we do go out there multiple times with door hangers.
Okay. I can see where with one time the wind might blow it away, and at least you're giving people multiple chances.
Yeah, we really try not to rely on the door tags. They're subject to, a lot of issues.
We get email addresses for our customers?
We do try to collect those. We're not always successful, but we are able to collect those, and we normally are doing that.
Okay. Any other questions?
Nope, not for me.
Not for me.
Moving on to section 5 of our agenda. 5.1, request approval for the fourth quarter reports from 2020. The RO to the council?
Yeah, I don't have much to add. Just a summary of what we saw in the last quarter of 2020.
Do we need our physical signatures, Joel?
No, we have scanned versions.
Okay.
We need a motion to approve the RO?
Yes.
So move.
I'll second it.
Moved and seconded. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Chair votes aye. Carried. Moving on. Approval of proposal for the EE booster pit engineering evaluation. Consulting agreement with AECOM.
A little background. The EE pit, we refer to it as, is an in-ground manhole pump station, very small, located at the intersection of Highway EE and Barron's Parkway. And the station pumps water from the non-boosted zone into the boosted industrial park zone. The vast majority of water in that zone is coming out of the Georgia Avenue pump station. And by vast majority, I mean, probably 98%. The EE pit pump was put in very early when the industrial park was not yet very large. It was just put in as kind of a very small supplemental pumping point. It has value for a couple reasons. One, it is apart from the major pump station, it's a separate asset, and if something were to happen in the other major station, we would have some capability left, although very small. It also is located really just down the street from one of our largest water users, and is a kind of an efficient way of pumping some water directly to them with very little loss. And the third function it serves, it takes water from a location in the south side zone where we don't have a lot of water usage, but by pushing water into the boosted zone, we're able to draw fresher, newer water to that area behind that the pit pump is drawing from. So we refer to that as it kind of freshens water in the whole area there when we utilize it. Water, if it's not used, can lose chlorine and stagnate. So that's one area where we like to use the pit pump to kind of freshen an area that does not have high demand. But the pit pump is aging. It's been there at least 30 years. I'm sorry, I didn't check exactly when it was put in, but it's about 30 years old. It's very small physically. It has one pump in it, and there's not really much room to do a whole lot more. So what we would like to do is we requested a proposal from AECOM, and they've been working on some of our pump station projects in recent years. They helped us evaluate locations for the new water tower. They helped us upgrade pumps at Georgia Booster Station. And they've also worked on our hydraulic model in the industrial park. So they're very, very well experienced to do booster pump projects for the utility. And we asked them to give us a proposal, which you see before you, and it's really an evaluation of the pit pump. Should it be expanded at that location? What are the ultimate constraints? We would like to have more flow capability. You know, currently it can produce maybe 400 gallons a minute, 350, 400. We'd like to really have it up to 1,000 gallons a minute capability. We would like an evaluation. Can the site support that in terms of drawing from where it does in the distribution system? We'd also like them to do a little bit of an evaluation. Is there a better place to locate this supplementary pump station? There are a few options. We don't really know without looking in the details. Maybe there's a better location to invest in. So basically, we asked them to do a technical evaluation for us, which, you know, might lead into a design project in detail down the road. So we have a proposal from AECOM for a fee not to exceed $22,980. The operations supervisor and I have reviewed this proposal, and we feel it's comprehensive and responsive. You know, again, AECOM is very experienced with our systems, so we could probably find someone to do this for cheaper, but I wouldn't make that recommendation. We did budget for this project, including design phases, so we had budgeted well above what this proposal entails in terms of cost.
Questions or comments from the board?
Oh, I have a ton of questions, but it's probably not appropriate to ask them at this point because they'd be design and function questions that would be answered later on as the design comes in.
Once the report comes in, okay.
Yeah. I guess one thing I could ask, is this on the 20-inch line that's down near NEMAC now?
No, it pumps from the end of Business Drive. I might have misstated that before. Business Drive and it pumps from the east into the old portion of the business park on Gateway Drive. I'm sorry, on Barron's Parkway.
Okay.
And it's pumping up. I'm sorry, Mark. It's pumping out of a 12-inch main that we, a few years ago, connected where that viaduct is there.
So, there, in other words, there's plenty of capacity to increase the size of the pumping.
We believe so, yeah.
And it's not like you're on a 4-inch line or something like that.
No.
Any other comments or questions?
No, I'm good.
So there was a, you budgeted for this, and you said it's looking very favorable right now financially?
Yeah, we budgeted, including a detailed design, you know, for a biddable project. So this is just the first phase. And because we haven't really settled on the project, we didn't want them to give us any further proposal.
Okay.
Okay, we need a motion to approve acceptance of the proposal from AECOM.
I say yes, let's go ahead. I move that we do so.
I will second that. All in favor say aye.
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 The chair votes aye, carry. Moving on. Approval of a rate case proposal from Baker Tilly.
Baker Tilly has prepared most of the rate cases in recent history for the utility, for the board. They're a very large, reputable firm. They've always done a very strong job, and they're very familiar with our financials, going back to Don Andre, who worked several decades on the utilities rate cases. And now, excuse me, under Jody Dobson and her team. because of the upcoming RWI, and really in anticipation of it, and also because of our new lead service line program, which we're incurring costs of up to $400,000 a year, we want to go back into the Public Service Commission and take a look at rates and request a rate increase here effective by the beginning of 2022. From past experience, we know that the PSC is quite backlogged, and we don't want to wait too long because we're already spending money on the LSL program without having rates to cover that specifically. And we know we've got new costs coming from RWI, so we want to get in time to have a rate increase in 2022. That would, you know, be setting the stage for the RWI project. The Public Service Commission does not approve rates for anticipated costs. You know, they don't do that. That's not part of their rate modeling. They only include current expenses and actual revenues. But we have enough going on now that we're confident that we would meet the requirements for a modest rate increase in early 2022. It's too early to tell what that would be. I would only be guessing until they really start digging into the numbers, but we would like to get that process started because we know it can drag out many, many months. The utility accountant and I did review the proposal. Most of it is boilerplate, which is typical, and the cost is the same as for the last rate case that they did for us. We felt that was reasonable. Cost is buried on page 6, kind of in the middle of the page. A fee of $18,520 for the rate study and application.
If I may comment, they have done an excellent job for quite a long time that they've been involved with the Sheboygan Water Utility. And as Joe said, they're a very reputable firm. They have always been very, very cognizant of what we need and very, very much willing to take our input and you know, put that into what they end up with their end product. So I would move we accept the proposal from Baker Tilly. A second?
I'll second that.
All right, for discussion. Any discussion?
I'm good.
Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Chair votes aye. Carried. Next, request approval of proposal from ONTEC for IT services.
Actually, I just wanted to give the board some background information here. The utility has does not employ a single IT professional on staff. We utilize outside vendors both for software in terms of our financial software program, which is quite large and extensive, and also for our more commonplace IT needs, you know, system setups and Ethernets and all that kind of stuff. We've been served well by a local firm for a number of years and have been happy with them for the most part. But we had a recent incident that caused us to take a second look and maybe a fresh look at our IT consultants. And I just wanted to give kind of a report on that. We had a situation where we did have a security breach, and the overall response to it through our IT firm, I felt was lacking in terms of responding to the initial breach and also kind of providing follow-up. And this wasn't a highly significant breach. Breach is probably even an excessive term. But because we deal with a lot of financial information, a lot of billing activity, account activity, any kind of issue for us is pretty serious. So after this particular incident and kind of a lack of follow-up from our ongoing provider, we did reach out to a firm out of Milwaukee area that has worked a lot with the CIVMIC Group, County Village Mutual Insurance Company. Outside the firm had also done a cybersecurity analysis for us several years ago. So we had some familiarity with them. They did a very thorough analysis, but we didn't hire them for follow-up. We did most of that through our local firm. The outside firm is larger. They have more staff in their operation. We did some reference checks and found a high level of satisfaction. We did have them mobilized to our site after this incident, and they began a response that our ongoing firm hadn't, you know, been concerned about doing for us. And this involved a number of like two-factor authentication processes rather than just, you know, a username and a password. You have username, password, and then the system texts you or emails you for an additional contact point. So we were pretty impressed with what they came in and did following this incident. One thing the utility accountant as well was expressing just that we really need to be confident that we have a high level of cybersecurity defenses and kind of an ongoing review. That's something that you just can't do once and think you're okay and, you know, 6 months down the road or even 2 months down the road. So we did find the this new firm has more of a proactive, where they're coming on a scheduled basis, not just reacting to all of a sudden we have a problem and we call in. They do work for a number of other municipalities, which again is reassuring, and they have some familiarity of, you know, the level of what we're doing and our need for security. So I think I just wanted to indicate to the board that we are following up and doing some review of IT and our consultancy, and we may want to move direction in the near future and try a new relationship going forward.
Have we put together a request for proposal at all?
We do have information, a proposal, yes.
Okay.
And I think, you know, short of the board's correction, IT is more of an ongoing administrative service. I don't know that we need a board approval on a decision like that, unless the board would prefer to do that.
This is pretty much, you're talking about protecting your business and office processes, right? Not the industrial processes?
Yeah, that's correct. This is solely business-oriented, Mark, not SCADA, nothing plant-oriented.
Because as I understand, all of the industrial processes are completely separated from the internet.
That's correct.
That was the article that I sent out this morning that came from last weekend's Wall Street Journal. It's talking about a water utility that had their industrial processes breached, which would be a whole nother can of worms. I mean, we need to be very, very concerned. We all appreciate how concerned we need to be about customer information and the financials. That certainly is important. I don't want to downplay that either.
Yeah, and I think the Florida incident did, you know, again, awaken our need to just kind of not be complacent and be more proactive. And that's why we're leaning towards a change. I don't feel like we've been as proactive as we could have been, and that's where we rely on the consultants really to guide that process. And I feel like we're just ready for a change.
Could I ask, what does the city do for IT support? They have an IT department, don't they?
They do. Yes, they have a separate department.
So are we going to be looking at trying to do something with the industrial side at the same time, or?
Well, the industrial side, I guess I would say a few things. It's, you know, basically hardened software at the level of these PLCs, which are kind of the base level of plant control systems. There's really a hardened software built into those units that's programmed by our vendor. It's not accessible to the internet or phone lines or anything like that. It's very hard to hack those units unless there's some encoded code within the software embedded that they come in the door with. And that has happened at the level of, you know, international attacks. You know, we've heard these, whatever, something in Iran where, you know, a governmental entity embedded something into their base code, and at a certain time point it activated and started creating mechanical havoc in systems. And it wasn't being controlled from afar. It was built into the base code of these units. You know, in theory, that could happen in these kind of SCADA PLC-based units. I'd say we have very little control over that aspect. One strength we always have is that our plant is staffed around the clock. In some areas of the country, they're not. They go automated. And, you know, there isn't a person checking and listening and verifying things directly. And that's actually, you know, I think most cyber attacks like that are ultimately detected by a person realizing something's wrong. So at the end of the day, we have that kind of protection as well. But things like keeping that system separate from our plant online systems is part of what the consultant does help us with. But really, the hardened PLC and the SCADA equipment comes from a different vendor who's more responsible for that security. And, you know, long ago, the operations supervisor, and I wholeheartedly agreed with them, took the viewpoint that radio systems are hard to breach. You know, they sound old-fashioned, but they're actually pretty secure in terms of, you know, you can't breach a radio system from across the seas, so to speak. And a number of our systems communicate with a secure radio systems.
In the electric utility side of the business, one of the big concerns is vendors coming in with thumb drives with some malicious software on them. So just to throw that out there.
Yeah, and one of the policies, you know, in some organizations, we haven't fully implemented that, is to not, you know, to disable those kind of means of, that you can't put a thumb drive into a laptop or a computer sitting on a workstation physically.
So are you expecting to present a proposal at a future meeting on this, or?
I think what I'm requesting is the board's authorization to accept the proposal. You know, it's a little difficult. If the board wants to see chargeable rates and such, I can certainly provide that. It's a little hard to give a, you know, anticipated cost breakdown other than chargeable rates and some planned activities, but I could certainly do that if the board wants to see those numbers.
Well, I'm certainly in favor of increased attention to cybersecurity. So you would have my support for that, Joel.
I don't have a problem with that either.
No,
so.
This is a big deal these days.
Right. It's very, very important. And it's not something you really want to take 2, 3, 4, 5 months to look at things and that type of thing. As you say, it's more of an administrative type thing. You're making those calls to make sure that everything that's going on, you know, at the utility is smooth and guarded. So. So we need a motion for Tom. Do you have any comments?
So I understand completely. This is not any kind of contract with these people. It's just, we're just saying we're going to use them as our provider, and it's going to be billed on as an as-needed basis. Is that correct?
It would be a yearly service contract, Tom. Just a one-year term at certain rates.
Okay, gotcha.
And with that, we need a motion to approve the proposal from ONTEC.
So moved.
I'll second it.
And moved and seconded. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Chair votes aye. Carried. Next, the proposal for replacement of GPS survey unit.
Yeah, our distribution as supervisors provided a summary. the engineering department does quite a bit of surveying of both a new project going in, and then after the project is in the ground, we shoot in its locations. We do this now with the GPS survey unit. Our current unit is aging and does not operate off the latest satellite configurations. It's not as accurate as modern units. And we also have some file compatibility issues with it. It's at least 12 years old, I believe, if not a little older. So they tried out two units, Spectra Focus 35 and the Trimble S5. There's quite a cost difference between the two, but they felt the Spectra Focus 35 meets our needs and would be very adequate and a big improvement over what we have now, and they requested purchase of that unit, which was budgeted for, and that would be used mostly by the utility engineer, the engineer tech, and also the CM crew at times.
What did we budget for that, John?
40.
40? Okay. And we've dealt with Siler in the past, correct?
We have, yes.
Yeah. Okay. I would move to approve.
I have one question, and this reflects my ignorance, but I'm curious about one thing. The present unit does not operate off the most current satellite configurations used in Wisconsin. I thought that it was a global positioning system. So I'm confused. Can you help my ignorance there, Joel?
I'm afraid I can't, Mark. I don't know the detailed answer to that. I could follow up and get that info to you.
It's probably not that big of a thing, but I hate being ignorant, but one thing.
I'm afraid I can't give you a precise answer on that.
Well, I like the fact that the equipment would provide the needed accuracy and functionality for a price less than budgeted, so I would second that.
It's also less than the other bid that we got, the other piece of equipment. All right, so moved and seconded. All in favor say aye.
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 Chair votes aye. Motion carried. All right. On to personnel.
Don't have any personnel updates for today.
Okay.
I ask one personnel question. You reminded me when you mentioned the GPS survey equipment, would our engineering tech would be using it. He was interested in pursuing a degree. Is he still able to do that? I'm wondering how he's doing.
He's doing great. He's on track to complete a four-year degree at UW Green Bay at Sheboygan in May.
Awesome.
And he will have a degree in civil and environmental engineering technology from UW Green Bay.
Awesome. Could you pass along my congratulations to him? Because from someone who pursued education while working full time, I know that's a challenge. So
I will do that. Yeah, he's done an awesome job.
Cool.
Great.
Thank you.
All right. Our next meeting would be on the 15th of March, the third Monday of March. Any problems with that? Anybody's calendar?
No, nope, not mine.
It'll be on my calendar here. It'll be on my calendar here shortly.
Okay. It's already on mine. Joe, that's good for you as well?
Yes.
All right. Then we need a motion to adjourn our meeting.
So moved.
I'll second it.
All in favor say aye and get up.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you.
Joe, how are you guys going? How are things going at home, Joe?
Going okay. Still in recovery, but making progress. Thank you.
Good.
That's going to be a tough road to hold.
That is.
I guess they want us to leave.
Okay.